So we'll continue the question answer session. I have got questions here which different devotees have asked. The first question is, in Bhagavad Gita chapter 13, text number 6 and 7, in the purport it is written, consciousness is represented by intelligence. How to understand this? Just for the understanding of the others about the question itself, in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, the subject matter is about the body as a field of activity and the soul inside the body as the knower of the field and the Supreme Lord, who is seated as Super Soul or Paramatma, is the super knower of all bodies. So, in explaining the field, Lord Krishna says in the 13th chapter, this field, which is the body, is made up of 24 different elements. And one of the elements is intelligence. Just like we have got this gross body made up of 5 elements, earth, water, fire, air and ether, we got a subtle body made up of mind, intelligence and false ego. Manas, buddhi, ahankara. So, but the soul is actually conscious, and soul has consciousness, both. I am spirit soul, so I am aware, or I'm conscious of my body, I'm conscious of my surroundings through my senses. So I'm conscious being, and I'm also consciousness, means the energy of the soul is spread throughout my body. So I am also consciousness. I'm conscious, I'm in consciousness. So this consciousness is represented by intelligence. What does this mean? This means, depending on what my consciousness is, accordingly my intelligence also will work. It's just like my consciousness is material consciousness, then the intelligence also will work in a materialistic way. That means if my consciousness is I want to enjoy materially, my intelligence will work how to enjoy materially. That's the way my intelligence is going to work. If my consciousness is spiritual consciousness, Krishna consciousness, my intelligence will work how to serve Krishna, how to follow Krishna's instructions. So in that sense, it is said here, consciousness is represented by intelligence. The next question, Bhagavad Gita is the best management guide. So that's what some people say. Can Bhagavad Gita be used for material management purposes? This is the question that is being raised. Now, Bhagavad Gita essentially is describing the spiritual science. But the learning from Bhagavad Gita can be applied even in other material situations. There is nothing wrong if we take some of the teachings of Bhagavad Gita and apply it in our daily life, even in our ordinary material duties. For example, Bhagavad Gita says that a person cannot be having happiness if the person is not having peace. Ashantasya kutas sukham. In the second chapter it is said. So if there is no happiness without peace, then I am seeking happiness, but I should also remember I cannot be happy without peace. So I have to first of all become peaceful. Like this, we can actually utilize the teachings of Bhagavad Gita even for our material situations. There is nothing wrong in that. The next question, how to apply Bhagavad Gita principles to minimize the restlessness caused by COVID-19? Bhagavad Gita talks about how to attain ultimate peace, the supreme peace. The basic principle of the Bhagavad Gita to attain peace is that we are not able to be peaceful if our mind is constantly agitated or disturbed by different material desires. What is it that is really the cause of disturbance in the mind? It is our material desires. So Bhagavad Gita teaches us how these material desires actually are worthless, and if we cultivate spiritual desires and we don't give importance to our material desires, then by cultivating spiritual desires we immediately become peaceful. So if we want a long-term solution for solving our problems, the Bhagavad Gita says you should not pursue material desires, but you should actually cultivate spiritual desires, and when you pursue spiritual desires you automatically become peaceful, and once you become peaceful the restlessness of the mind is completely stopped. Next question, I am an ignorant person. I realize becoming a devotee of Krishna I can escape from the material world. How can I become a devotee of Krishna? Directly the Bhagavad Gita is teaching us that to become a devotee of Krishna one has to follow certain principles, simple principles of Bhakti Yoga. It begins with chanting of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, a fixed number of times every day. And then we chant, we hear, and we count also. So minimum of, it is recommended to chant minimum of 108 times this Hare Krishna mantra. And then also read books on the philosophy of Krishna consciousness and understand the basis of this whole practice of Bhakti Yoga. So like this, if you study the Bhagavad Gita, then you can get to know the principles of Bhakti Yoga, and if you practice the principles of Bhakti Yoga, you can become a devotee of Krishna. Next question. In second chapter, after giving soul knowledge to Arjuna, Krishna gives devotional knowledge. What is Krishna's intention in this? Knowledge about the soul is part of the complete spiritual knowledge. It begins with understanding each one of us, we are not the body, we are spirit soul. But then we should also understand that apart from the many different individual souls, each person within the body, there is the Supreme Lord Krishna, who is also within everybody's heart as the super soul. And there is a relationship. Each one of us, we have a relationship with Krishna. So, devotional knowledge means understanding that I am related to Krishna, each one of us. I means each one of us, we are related to Krishna. And to revive that lost relationship with Krishna is the goal of life. And to do that, Krishna has given us the knowledge about this devotional service or Bhakti Yoga. So that's why Bhakti Yoga begins with understanding I am not this body and spirit soul. So therefore, first Krishna gives this knowledge about the soul. Then afterwards he describes the knowledge of the super soul. Then he describes the relationship. And that is what Bhakti Yoga is all about. Next question. Krishna has instructed us to fix our mind on Him and remain non-judgmental. This is in chapter 12, Bhakti Yoga. Can we explain this bhakti to intellectuals and youngsters who doubt existence of God? Yes, we can discuss the subject matter of bhakti with intellectuals, with youngsters. Yes, it is. Now, when it is said here, somebody who doubts the existence of God, can we discuss about bhakti? First of all, we have to explain to them that somebody may have some conception of God which is according to some misunderstanding. Everybody has some conception. Even if they say there is no God, something they are thinking is God which they think is not correct. So in any case, the correct knowledge about God is in the authorized, authentic scriptures like Bhagavad Gita. Now, even Bhagavad Gita, unless you read or study a authorized translation, you will not get the correct understanding. Just like the original verses of the Bhagavad Gita are in Sanskrit. So the Sanskrit verses, you know, different people have translated differently. But this Bhagavad Gita, written by the founder Acharya of ISKCON, His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, is based on what is called as parampara understanding. Prabhupada is not giving his own personal opinion or personal viewpoint. Prabhupada is teaching us or translating based on the knowledge that is handed down since the beginning of creation, beginning from Krishna himself, the original speaker of the Bhagavad Gita. So what Krishna explained to Arjuna, that understanding is coming down from guru to disciple in what is called as a disciplic succession. Guru Shishya Parampara in Sanskrit. In English we say the spiritual master and disciple coming in a chain of disciplic succession. And that is explained by Krishna in the fourth chapter itself. This knowledge has to be received in that disciplic succession. Then only one can properly understand the subject matter. So Prabhupada has presented the understanding perfectly as it is received in the disciplic succession. So this is the most authoritative, authorized, authentic Bhagavad Gita translation. Otherwise, there are so many other translations which people have done according to their own viewpoint, their understanding, their interpretation. No. This standard knowledge is not subject to anybody's interpretation. It is not subject to anybody's opinion. Just like you go to a college to study physics. It doesn't matter which college you go, because there is a standard understanding of physics which is there all over the world, and whichever college you go, they will teach you the standard understanding. Newton's law is Newton's law, whichever college you study. It cannot be changed from college to college or textbook to textbook. It cannot change. Similarly, the Bhagavad Gita explains who is God. It's a very definite understanding. Who is God? What are the characteristics of God? What is the way to identify God? What is the way to know God? What is the way to understand God? It's very, very standard, clear, perfect, proper understanding. One understanding. There is no question of two understandings or multiple understandings about God. No. So therefore, you have to study, you have to read, you have to get this knowledge from the proper source, that is the Bhagavad Gita translated by Srila Prabhupada, the founder Acharya of ISKCON. And Prabhupada's translation into English has been further translated into many different languages, all other languages. So anybody reads this, or the discussion is based on what is explained here, that's a standard, a proper, authentic explanation. Then the question of doubt about existence of God will all vanish. And it can be discussed with intellectuals, it can be discussed with youngsters, it can be discussed with anybody. Next question. Why must one read Bhagavad Gita before reading Srimad Bhagavatam? Bhagavad Gita gives us the foundation for understanding the spiritual subject matter which is discussed in Srimad Bhagavatam at an advanced level. It's just like before somebody studies advanced calculus in mathematics, they have to know arithmetic, they have to know algebra, they have to know trigonometry. Without all this understanding, they cannot directly go to calculus. Similarly, Srimad Bhagavatam is an advanced subject matter, spiritual subject matter. Bhagavad Gita gives the foundation. Therefore, it is recommended that one study Bhagavad Gita and then study Srimad Bhagavatam. Next question. Choice of devotional service can be due to pious activities of one's previous life. Can it also be due to the fate of a person? So two different questions. Is devotional service due to one's previous pious activities in the past life? Devotional service is not based on anything material. Due to my past pious activities, I may be having some good birth or some good amount of money or good amount of knowledge, material knowledge, intelligence, etc. But bhakti is independent of all these past pious activities. Bhakti is based on one's personal interest in knowing the absolute truth, the ultimate reality, the ultimate source of everything, the ultimate cause of all causes. So bhakti is a very, very fundamental thing. Devotion or devotional service is a very fundamental thing. So until one is inquisitive about knowing, who am I, what is this world, where have I come from, these fundamental questions, when they are raised and one seeks proper answers to these fundamental questions, until then bhakti cannot begin. So bhakti begins irrespective of one's past pious activities or whatever. Can bhakti be due to fate of a person? No, never. Bhakti is never due to fate. Next question. What is the basis of Arjuna's doubt in Bhagavad Gita 5th chapter 1st verse? 5th chapter 1st verse is the opening of the 5th chapter where Arjuna asks a question from Krishna. I'll read the question, Arjuna's question. First of all, you ask me to renounce work, and then again you recommend work with devotion. Now will you kindly tell me definitely which of the two is more beneficial? Arjuna's question is, should I renounce work or should I work with devotion? So what is the basis of Arjuna asking this question, if that is what is asked here? In the 3rd chapter, Krishna explained performing karma yoga, or work as should be done as sacrifice to Vishnu, which is working in devotion. Now in the 4th chapter, Krishna described transcendental knowledge based on which one gives up all material activities as unnecessary, because in transcendental knowledge one understands there are three kinds of activities. There is activity which is performed in accordance with the scriptural injunctions, according to directions of scriptures, which are called pious activities, and there are sinful activities which are violation of the scriptural injunctions, which are against the scriptures or the laws of karma. And the third kind of activity is devotional activity or devotional work, which is above both pious and impious activities. So these three kinds of activities were explained, and it was clearly stated that one has to give up work which is of the nature of pious activity or sinful activity, both, because both are leading to bondage. But it is clearly told that give up this type of activities, pious and impious, in order to engage in devotional activity, in order to engage in the third type of activity, that is devotional work. Normally, everybody who is little familiar with the Vedas or the devotion or the scriptures, they only know two types of activity, punya and papa. Punya karma, papa karma. Pious activity, sinful activity. But any activity, either pious or sinful, which is done with a view of getting some material benefit in this world, is cause of bondage. People generally think, if I do sinful activity, that's a cause of material bondage. But Bhagavad Gita explains, even pious activities, punya karma also, is a cause of bondage. So what is the way out of this material bondage? It is doing devotional work, which is neither punya karma nor papa karma. So Bhagavad Gita is introducing us to a third type of activity, which is generally not found in any of the regular scriptures, regular books on philosophy of karma, in that you don't find this third type of activity. It's only in the Bhagavad Gita, in the fourth chapter, Krishna explains this. So therefore, this question of Arjuna, whether I should renounce work or I should work in devotion, there is no difference between renouncing work and working in devotion. Renouncing work means don't do the first two kinds of activities. Don't do punya karma, don't do papa karma, because both are leading to bondage. We should do the third type of activity, that is working in devotion. So Krishna explains in this chapter, if you see the read the later verses of this fifth chapter, there is no difference between renouncing work and working in devotion. There's no difference. Both are leading to the same goal. Next question. If we all belong to Krishna's abode, then why did we come into this material world? Good question. Yes, we belong to Krishna's abode, but we have been forced to come to this material world because we have a desire to be independent of Krishna. We have a desire to be independent of Krishna. So, to understand our position in relationship with Krishna, in the spiritual world, everyone is engaged in devotional service to Krishna out of love. So devotional service is never forced. It is never forced on anybody. Devotional service is always performed voluntarily, because it is something done out of love. So if a person who is engaged in devotional service does not want to serve Krishna or wants to take Krishna's position, why should everybody serve Krishna? Why not everybody serve me? Why can't I take Krishna's position? Or why can't I be independent of Krishna? Let me be independent of Krishna. Let me be away from Krishna. So such a desire actually makes us to take birth in this material world. This is the world where one can forget Krishna, one can try to be independent of Krishna, one can try to take Krishna's position, as Krishna is the center of everything. One can try to be, I can try to be the center of my household or my community or my state or my country or whatever. So Krishna allows this, but then there are laws which are governing in this material world, all our activities, the laws of karma. And the laws of karma are simply binding us to the cycle of birth and death. To live in this world or to be in this world and try to pursue our independent desires means to actually be under the clutches of the material laws, which are very, very stringent. So it is foolishness to think that by being independent of Krishna in this world, I can be happy, or I can really get ultimate peace or ultimate happiness. No, that is never possible. So one realizes this foolishness that actually I cannot be independent of Krishna. Even if I try to be independent of Krishna, I am still dependent on Krishna. Even in the material world, we are dependent on Krishna. Of course, in the spiritual world, everyone depends on Krishna. So Krishna is the only maintainer, is the only shelter for everyone, whether in the material world, whether in the spiritual world. Under all circumstances, in all situations, every living being is completely sheltered by Krishna. Krishna is the only one who is called Ashraya Tattva. He is the only shelter for everyone. And we are all Ashrita, we are all sheltered. Everybody else in the entire cosmic manifestation is sheltered by Krishna. So there is no other shelter for us other than Krishna. And Krishna is also not a material master. Krishna has also got love for each one of us. We have love for Krishna. Krishna has love for us. So to rediscover that forgotten relationship with Krishna of love is the goal of life. Having come to this world and having experienced different kinds of miseries and different kinds of difficulties and different kinds of problems, it is important to realize actually who we are, who is Krishna and what is the cause of our problem. And then we follow the instructions of Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita and reinstate ourselves in our original position. Next question. If the soul is indestructible, then why animal slaughter is abominable? Good question. The soul is indestructible, the soul cannot be killed, but as long as I or you or any person, soul, is in a body, the body is a place of residence for the soul presently. It is not my permanent place of residence, but as long as I am living in this body, in this world, or in this life, this body is my place of residence. Let's say, for example, you are living in a certain house. Now, you are not the house, but still, if I damage your house, I break your house, I destroy your house, isn't it an inconvenience for you? Think about it. I'm not doing any harm to you. I'm not doing any harm to you. I'm just going to destroy your house, or I'm going to break your house. I even break a window of your house. How much inconvenience it is for you, right? To live in the house, has got to have some facilities. It has to have got some security features. All that is necessary for you to live in the house. You are not the house, but you still require some facilities to live in the house. Similarly, every living being inside a body has got a certain facility to live in that body. So you have no right to actually give them trouble by telling that they are, oh, you're not the body, I can do whatever I want with your body. No, you cannot do that. Next question. Where is the soul located in our body? What is mind? Soul is located in the heart region. Soul is located in the heart region. This is what the scriptures say. But the soul, we should remember, if we try to search within the heart, you cannot find the soul, because soul is, first of all, it is not material. What we can perceive, what we can search, what we can try to see using different instruments, different methods of searching, contemplation, different methods of analysis, intellectually, mentally, philosophically, whatever you may do, soul is not subject to any of these type of analysis. That's why you have to hear from Krishna. You have to hear from the proper authority, spiritual authority. What is the soul? What are the characteristics of the soul? How to perceive the soul? How to understand the soul? Everything, that's why you have to study the Bhagavad Gita. You have to understand the Bhagavad Gita, what Krishna explains about the soul. What is mind? Mind is one of the 8 elements of which this body is made. Mind is a part of the subtle body. We have got a gross body and a subtle body. Subtle body is made up of the mind, the intelligence, and the false ego. So mind is an instrument for us to utilize. Mind is the seat of emotions, and mind is where our feelings are. So we cannot again see the mind. We can perceive the mind. We cannot see the mind. We cannot use any of our 5 senses to actually get to know about the mind like that. None of our 5 senses are useful for that. So we have to only understand, because everyone says, oh, my mind is very disturbed, or my mind is very peaceful. So everybody is able to understand, yes, everyone has got a mind, but that mind is subtle, so it is not a subject matter for perception by the 5 senses or anything like that. Next question. How does chanting differ from other devotional services? Why more stress is given to chanting? Chanting is one of the methods of doing devotional service. As described in the Bhagavatam, there are 9 different methods of doing devotional service. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atmanivedanam. So these are 9 different ways of doing devotional service, of which the first 2, Shravanam, Kirtanam, hearing and chanting, are the most fundamental methods of doing devotional service. They are also very, very easy, practical. Just like first you hear about the Hare Krishna mantra, and then you chant, you repeat, you vibrate your tongue and say Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So you chant, but before you chant, you should have heard. Then only you can chant. So you hear, you learn the Hare Krishna mantra, then you chant. So then you chant and hear, chant and hear, chant and hear. So chanting and hearing is the most most fundamental method of doing devotional service. Why stress is given to chanting? Because it is the recommended effective process for practicing bhakti, especially in this Kali Yuga. In Kali Yuga, the scriptures are telling that chanting and hearing the holy name of Krishna is the most effective way of self-realization. So therefore, chanting is given stress. Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, 46th verse, is describing work as worship. How to know what is our duty or swadharma? Yes, work is worship, provided one is working according to the directions given by the Supreme Lord Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, or one is working according to the Vedic injunctions. You cannot do any work and consider that work as worship. That's an important thing to understand. Now, what type of work is considered worship, or how to know what is my duty? So, to know our duty, the standard Vedic method is the Varnashrama Dharma system. In the Varnashrama Dharma system, the entire society is divided into 4 occupational divisions and 4 spiritual divisions. 4 occupational divisions are Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. The intellectual class, the martial class, the mercantile class, and the laborer class. And the 4 spiritual divisions are the Brahmachari, Grahastha, Vanaprastha, Sannyas, which means student life, householder life, retired life, and renounced life. So these divisions automatically one fits into one of the occupational divisions and one of the spiritual divisions, and accordingly everything is described, what one should do, what one should not do, etc. But it is not very practical to follow that Varnashrama Dharma system, because society now in the modern age is not organized like that. So in the present situation, it is recommended that irrespective of what occupation one may be engaged, everyone should actually worship Krishna by chanting and hearing the Hare Krishna mantra, the holy name of Krishna. Everybody should follow that particular way of worshipping. So in addition to whatever work you may be doing for earning your livelihood or for whatever duties you may have in your family or in the society or in the community, whatever, along with that you have to also chant and hear the holy name of the Supreme Lord. And also, to sanctify your work, a portion of the result of your work, which is, let's say, most cases, the result of any work a person does, is the money you are earning, the salary you are getting, or the profit you are getting from a business. So, a portion of that money, you have to give it to Krishna. That is what Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, sacrifice the results of your work for me. So how to sacrifice results of one's work to Krishna? That means one should donate a part of one's earnings to the propagation of Krishna consciousness, to the Krishna consciousness movement. That is the way to actually make work into worship. Our sampradaya is Madhva sampradaya, but a different sect accept Madhvacharya as the acharya and not onwards. If we jump over the acharya, it's Maryada Vatikrama. How to understand this? What is explained in the scriptures is there are different sampradayas or different disciplic successions coming from Krishna originally. So Madhva Sampradaya is accepting the lineage coming from Krishna through Madhvacharya. And we are also in the Madhva Sampradaya in the sense that after Madhvacharya, there have been many other acharyas. So we accept the line that is coming from Madhvacharya through Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That's called the Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya. So we accept the current Acharya Srila Prabhupada as the representative of this disciplic succession starting from Krishna. Krishna, Brahma, Madhvacharya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, down like that. Now there are other followers of Madhvacharya who accept another line coming from Madhvacharya, coming through Madhvacharya from Krishna. So both are valid. Everybody has to accept the current acharya in the parampara or on the discipline, in the disciplic succession. Madhvacharya is a previous acharya, and one has to accept the current acharya. So when they accept the current acharya, that is the proper way. Time up, so we will discuss more questions tomorrow. If you have more questions, you can also, anybody else has more questions, you can send some questions tomorrow. Tomorrow also we'll continue this question answer session. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.